Always a favourite on every rural road. Hyundai Country Calendar.
We love farming. There's nothing else we want to do.
Some people say it's a lifestyle. I say it's a life sentence.
Farming with an eye to the future.
Part of the succession planning will be all children will be inheriting debt along with farmland.
Being fair to everybody is a really hard issue.
Another lovely day in paradise today, Catherine.
Ellen and Kathy Donaldson run a family farm with their kids.
Family means absolutely everything to me, and having Kathy and the children alongside from day-to-day business, it's a pleasure.
Family are the reason I get out of bed in the morning. Working every day with family just makes it more of a pleasure.
But the couple's also thinking about a future when they're gone.
Having three children, we have got to be very careful with our succession planning, so we're fair to every child and also create space for ourselves to live.
Kathy and Ellen farm sheep and cattle in the Paparoa Valley near Taumarunui. They have three children and two have always wanted to be farmers.
I've had a love for animals and dogs especially, working dogs, since I was very small.
Ellen and Kathy's daughter Jess was a keen farmer even as a youngster.
She always wanted to be mustering, so at a young age, at the age of six, she got her first hunterway. And she'd come out mustering with me, and I'd have her in the bottom corner somewhere, and she would tell me, "Now, Dad, why have I got six sheep in the bottom corner while you've got 2,000 ewes around the top?"
Get in, Duke. Brief.
So I gave Jessie a heading dog, and from that point on, at that tender age, she went out mustering.
And ever since I have had a big team of dogs.
Get in, Dime. Get in, lady.
They're probably all very spoiled, but I love working them, yeah. I've just knew I want to be a farmer. I love the challenges every day.
Jess did a Bachelor of Ag Science at Massey University.
And since then I went down to Lake Tekapo and worked on a station down there in the high country and then came back to Taumarunui.
It's rugged country, but Jess enjoys it.
I did actually used to do a lot of horse riding up until the kids, and I'm pregnant at the moment, so I'm not really riding, but I love walking, doesn't bother me. Yeah, I walk all day, happy.
Tom enjoyed different things to Jesse on the farm, but he was the one that asked the different questions. He asked me why the animals were in this paddock or what's happening on the farm. So at quite a young age, sure, I sort of detected that he could possibly be a farmer.
When I really thought I was going to be a farmer was probably early teens, and I was really into the machinery, like the bulldozers and things, driving Dad's bulldozer and stuff like that. And then after school, went to uni down at Lincoln, and then did a bit of travelling and working on other farms around the place, including over in Aussie. Met my wife over there and came back to New Zealand and, yeah, started working on the family farm again.
Tom and Jess's brother, Sam, lives in Auckland.
Sam, our oldest, he was a bit more intellectual, but he never had the same farming interests or didn't ask the same questions as a child. He went to university and did an engineering degree and became a mechanical engineer. Come on, girls.
Today, Ellen and Kathy are bringing their yearling heifers down off the hill country.
They've been up there since March, once they were weaned, and now we bring them down ready for prepping for AIing in November.
Leaving a legacy is never far from their minds.
It's good to leave the land behind for the children, but I don't want them to feel controlled by it once we've gone. Being fair to everybody is a really hard issue, and it's not something you can overcome immediately. It's something that needs to be worked through with time.
The best advice we got was to just take our time. Let the children work it out for themselves which one direction in life they want to go.
Get up, Ed.
Let them meet their partners. Because if you try and make a decision too early, you can guarantee you'll make the wrong one.
Alan and Kathy's original aim was to own one big farm, but they've ended up with several smaller blocks.
You just walk down the track behind them.
Yeah. Originally, we always thought that we would like to have one big block. It's easier to manage, everything's, you know, in one place, but it wasn't to be, and we started to just get what we could in close proximity. And in the end, it's been, I think, the best thing we did, because all best intentions, not all family members want to work together.
And Kathy and I still want to farm as well. We're not planning on retiring. And we've let the children know that, so they know also. So by having different properties, there's something for all of us.
They've ended up with four farms. Alan and Kathy run one, Jess and Tom manage one each, and a manager runs the fourth.
We also have the opportunity to be able to sell their property in the future to be able to cover Sam. And that's the beauty about having different farms. Oh, that's like eating chocolate.
Buying farms means taking on debt, sometimes quite a lot.
You've got to be in a position where you can definitely sleep at night and borrow money. Some people can't. I can sleep quite well.
They look good, don't they?
I worked out a long time ago that if I didn't borrow money, I'm never going to get ahead in life.
They're definitely not going to be getting freehold farms. They will inherit a certain amount of that debt. So the way we work things mostly is Jess and Tom run their farms. Al and I have our small block and our stud cattle and elite sheep. We do all those pretty well on our own. Most of the yard work, Alan and I, we will be helping at that quite a lot, so we're always there for weighing, drenching, docking. We all discuss overall management issues together.
So at your place?
Yeah, I got a bit earlier this year, I'm thinking. So
we're going to dock all the lambs at your place this year?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We'll do the whole
we have a family meeting probably four times a year.
I might decide to take your mother on a holiday. It's a good place for us to be at docking.
These days, the kids obviously have their own ideas, so, you know, they want to change things a little bit on their own parts, which is good. It's good. They have, you know, they listen to modern techniques or whatever's happening, and they bring those to the table and we discuss them, and if it's a reasonable idea, they give it a go. Yeah, so we things are changing a little bit, yeah, but sometimes, you know, the old tried and true works best.
Today, Alan is acting as his son Tom's assistant on Tom's Te Awa block.
It's a bit wet down in here. So we'll just bring the rams along the river edge there, then I'll hunt them up that bit of a hill and a track and bring them on the fence there. So she's going to grab that gate and I'll just walk up to this point here.
Yep, okay. Ram shearing's coming up. So we're mustering and then take them up the road about a couple of K or thereabouts and shed them up this evening.
Go right. Get him, Christian.
Alan's dad came to this part of the country when he had a motorbike accident at the age of 23. He lost a leg. A plumber by trade, he got a job on a farm and ended up buying it.
He's a pretty determined sort of guy. He had a peg leg because they couldn't put a foot on it. He learnt to share, obviously ride a horse, had to get special stirrup made up for a saddle. Even with one leg, you're still sharing 250 or better a day. So, yeah, he's pretty determined.
Stay there, Joe!
As children growing up on rural farms, like we all did in that era, Dad taught us how to drive tractors, bulldozers, work chainsaws and a handpiece. And those are skills that we learnt very young.
Alan was shearing by the time he was 12. It was a skill that would see him become a New Zealand champion. It's ram shearing time on the Donaldson's fattening block in the Paparoa Valley near Taumaranui. It's a family event, and Alan still likes to wield a handpiece.
Started shearing when I was 12 years old, then moved into shearing on weekends and during school holidays from my father and his uncle in Kaitiki Valley when we lived there. I really loved doing it. I enjoyed it. When I was shearing, you know, I think all sheriffs can relate to this. You grow into it, you get enthusiastic, and in the morning you just can't wait to get back in that catching pen door. Someone who doesn't do it probably thinks we're stupid, but that's what happens. It's a great lifestyle.
Alan started his own shearing contracting business. He met Kathy when she joined the gang.
She was in Dunedin University and came to Tamarindoa looking for a job, and a good place to make money for students them days was to go working in wool sheds. We grew the business around Tamarindoa and down into Wairuru and Taiapi. And Kathy and I used to employ roughly around about 80 to 100 people during the main season.
How's it going, all right?
Yeah.
Back holding up?
Yeah.
Good. Quite happy with the way the fleeces are coming off.
Oh, good.
And we work side by side the whole way. Have our little ups and downs now and again, as you would expect, but generally we've got a pretty good working relationship. And we wouldn't be where we are today if it wasn't for each other. We really have worked well as a team.
I think you could guys just ease up a bit because I'm getting pulled up. I'm weighing these ram fleeces off our ram hoggets. So we weigh the fleeces for data recording for sill records. Just part of one of the things we weigh for these rams, which are our elite flock. And I'm just recording them. This reads the EID tags, which we have in the ram's ears. So this will read it, saves me having to read it by eye, which is good because my eyes aren't so good.
Wool used to be a good earner for farmers. Now it costs them to take it off.
This year, probably the expense of shearing our sheep was about $50,000 for the year, whereas in the past we would have had an income of in excess of $100,000.
Alan's character led him to set himself some challenges.
To be honest, I'm very competitive, especially when I was shearing. I had goals in my life that I wanted to achieve. One was I decided early in life I'd like to win the Golden Shears. In 1983, I was fortunate enough to be able to do that. And then I wanted to shear merinos because South Island has given me a bit of jibbing about North Island not being able to shear merinos. And I managed to win the Alexandra Fine Wool Show in 83 as well.
After winning the Golden Shears, Alan decided he could break some shearing records.
A bit of a belief out there in those days that if you shore shows, you couldn't do records. So I thought, oh yeah, I'll prove them wrong too. So I managed to shear a solo record of 586 four wheel ewes, but my best effort was in a four stand record where I managed to shear 659 four wheel ewes in a 9 hour day.
During the calving season, Alan and Kathy are out checking for new calves twice a day.
At calving time, we birth, weigh all our calves.
And then we're putting a nate tag in the calves right here.
Oh, heavy calf. Strong.
Recording whether it's heifer male, obviously, and its mother. That's the first bit of data recording we do on these animals, which is quite extensive.
37 kilos. It's a good time to bond with your cattle. Okay, this one's 6'10".
Kathy knows each cow by number.
Over the generations, you obviously learn them quite well and their progeny and how well their progeny do and what their pedigrees are, their bulls, their size, what does well, yeah, and you get quite close to them. Yeah, they become quite family.
We've been breeding Angus cattle now for 14 years, stud cattle that is. We've always been involved with Angus breeding all our lives, but we just saw it as an opportunity to expand our farming business in the form of making space for our children, because it gives Kathy and I an interest that we can continue doing at an older age while the kids take on the other part of the business. Now the heifer calf.
Jess has bred these calves on Te Maere Station, and now their time in her care is finished. She's handing them over to brother Tom to fatten.
These are yearling heifers. They've been born on the farm. The replacements have been kept and will be retained. These average 250 kilos, and these are going to head around to the fattening farm, to Te Awa.
This block, it's a bit easier contour than the other hill blocks, so we can bring the stock in off those hill blocks here and we can monitor their daily weight gains and can just control pasture and their feed a lot better and keep control of everything.
Every animal is weighed when it arrives on Tom's block. They're then weighed regularly till they leave for the works.
It's over a kilo a day, that one.
Well, that's good through the winter.
Yeah. I run this block. It's all down to me what weight gain gets on all the animals and for all recording and just how the block is run and operates.
Tom may be his own boss, but he has responsibilities to the rest of the family.
Bit of pressure sometimes to make sure that the animals keep moving forward. Also trying to get animals off the other blocks so that they can lighten off and keep moving forward as well, so their stock's in a good condition for when key points when the ram or the bull's going out.
While Tom manages the farm, his wife Louise runs their side hustle. When the Donaldsons bought the Te Awa block bordering the Whanganui River, they saw an opportunity for diversification, a glamping site.
It's glamorous camping is what it is. So basically you get your accommodation but with all the luxuries.
G'day, g'day.
Hey Lou, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good to see you.
Tom's wife Lou runs the glamping business.
How are you?
It's new and she's invited friends Nick and Joe for a test run.
Oh wow.
This is amazing.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
I got Lewis, the local guy, did the all the cabinetry. All the timbers from Nana and Gargi's farm, so they felled one of the trees and yeah, made it into that, which is pretty wicked.
Where did you get the basin from, Lou?
I bought it when I was about 18 from Australia and I've carried it around ever since.
They imported the tent from South Africa.
We really wanted to buy local, but we also wanted something really unique as well. So when we found the company Tentacle, they were from South Africa, and we were able to custom make it so that the big windows could face out towards the river and just custom design it specifically for this environment.
This is awesome.
Tom and Lou have teamed up with jet boat company Blazing Paddles to offer packages. They reckon today's holidaymakers don't want to just sit and look at the view. She calls them active relaxers.
I can speak from experience, there's nothing worse than going somewhere and just having to sit down and pretend to relax. It's not very relaxing. Whereas here, you can, there's fishing, there's canoeing, kayaking, jet boat, the mountain's only 40 minutes away, the timber trail, so there's a whole lot of adventures and activities you can do around here as well.
Alan Donaldson's father worked on Te Maere Station when he first moved to the valley in the 1960s. And then bought it. Today it's managed by his daughter, Jess.
This house is not only special to me, it's actually special to our family. We've been here for 10 months now. Prior to that, my Nana and Granddad were still living here, right up until they passed. My father was born in this house. Nana's created this beautiful garden here, and my grandfather worked this land all his life, so it's very special to our family.
It's my favourite time of the year, spring. It's the start of a new season. The lambs, well, not only lambs, all the baby animals have been born. It's warming up. I don't like the cold very much. And feed's coming away, and it is. It's just a happy time of the year.
For Jess, hand-rearing lambs is a joy. Her daughter Isla gets to share the task.
Oh, I love them. No, I've had pet lambs and all kinds of pets since I was very little. I don't go looking for them, but if I drive past them, I cannot leave them behind, no. They're triplet lambs, so that's the third lamb I've taken off, Mum. Depending on what Isla wants to do, whether they'll stay here as pets, that's what I used to do, but otherwise, yeah, they'll just get sold with the rest of the lambs.
In addition to Te Maere Station, which Jess manages for the family, she and her husband, Callum McCrosty, own their own block nearby. They've started to experiment with a different breed of sheep, the Wiltshire.
Their number one thing is their full shedding ability. They will fully shed their fleece once a year.
a number of things got us sort of interested in the first place. Firstly, it was the wool, the ongoing decrease in wool prices and increase in shearing costs. Not only that, a lot of work comes with shearing and wool, dags, dipping, you know, just the general time in yards and general time of getting sheep to and from yards. And so far, we really like the sheep. They're producing well for us. Other things that we're finding with these sheep, we're getting a lot less ewe deaths.
Lady.
Our death rate's well down, mainly in that lambing period.
Sit, lady, sit.
Wilchers shed their wool all over the paddock.
I think a lot of people have an image of a mess on farm, wool lying everywhere. It's not that. Yes, this time of the year, for a couple of months, there'll be a light dusting of wool, but it doesn't come off in big chunks. If you've got them highly stocked in the area, it almost looks like a light dusting of very light snow, in a way.
They may look untidy to outsiders, but not to Jess.
I like it. I think it's neat. That's them, that's their thing, and yeah, no, I'm used to it. And I don't think they look messy, no. No.
Righto, Hemi. Righto. Get in, Hemi. Get in here, Hemi.
Definitely a lot of unknown still. I guess they're still a new breed to New Zealand in terms of there's not a lot of them in the country.
The Wiltshires, to me, are definitely going to be the way of the future, where we can have an animal that's going to reproduce and we can pretty well farm it like a cattle beast and still get meat production.
Alan and Kathy have put a lot of effort into creating a succession plan for their children. Statistics suggest that a lot of farmers' wills end up in court.
Apparently between 75 and 80% of rural wills do get contested. We're hoping that we're in the 20% category and we are taking our time and working through with our children so we get it right.
I'm looking forward to taking a step back a bit and working towards handing it over to the kids.
Calendar was brought to you by Hyundai New Zealand.